ॐ श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ॐ श्रुतिस्मृतिपुराणानामालयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादशङ्करं लोकशङ्करम् अमानित्वादिगुणञ्च ज्ञानोपायं सम्यग्राहयेत्. So, this is what is called first things first. So, you start Sarvam Khalvidam Brahma or Brahma Jagat Karanam, Abhinna Nimitto Padanam Karanam. Like that you start, which is all correct. I am not saying it is not so. It is indeed so. But you end up with what is called a conceptual Brahman. So, ultimately you have to discover that the Brahman, which is the efficient as well as material cause of the universe, is yourself. That means you are the material and the efficient cause of the universe. That is what you have to discover. Pratyaka Bhinnam Brahma. Therefore, you have to start with yourself. And when you look at yourself, you have to leave the body behind. You have to rise above the body. You have to rise above the body. When the body is not healthy, you will not be able to rise above the body. A sick body will hold you back. It will not allow you to go beyond. Similarly, an impure mind, which is another name for sick mind. But generally, if we say sick mind, it gives a different meaning. That people are not healthy, mind mentally, therefore they go to say doctor and all that. Not in that sense, an unhealthy mind means an impure mind. So, an impure mind will hold you back. You will not be able to get out of the prison house called the mind. But if you purify the mind, you can get beyond the mind. You see, I always give an example, if you don't mind. In India, when you vacate the house, You throw everything and make it as dirty as possible and then you vacate. Then the owner comes and puts two people and gets it cleaned to give to some other tenant. While vacating, human mentality, you know. So they make it as dirty as possible and then vacate it. Whereas in America, when they vacate a house, they keep it spot clean. Now you can go and occupy it right away. You need not do anything more. They keep it very clean. If some repairs are to be done, they get them done. And then vacate the place. You have to vacate the mind that way. You have to do it American way, not the Indian way. So first purify the mind and then vacate it. Means rise above the mind. And that is the principle. Then I said it, repeat, I am repeating, I suppose. You see, gaining divinity, people have all kinds of notions about it. They are all waiting for an opportunity when they will come face to face with the God. And then God, instead of looking this way, that way, will look at me. And if possible, God will give me an embrace also. That is what people are waiting for. You are just waiting before a painted door. The idea is it will never open. That is the idea. That is not how you meet God. There is a way to meet God. Meeting God is same as meeting godliness. God is a tattvam, not a person. Tattvam, that is the godliness. Godliness is the God. Divinity is the divine. And therefore, you meet the godliness face to face by becoming godly. You see, people say God a dozen times per day. You take to the name of God 100 times per day or even 1,000 times. We have Sahasranama and all that. So, taking to the name of God so many times is one thing, And being godly is altogether different thing. Taking it to the name is the easiest. Being godly is a tall order. And therefore, people take to the easy thing and give up the more arduous thing. Therefore, saying God, God a dozen times doesn't mean anything. So, you have to be godly within. You have to be godly. That is how it is. You should be divine in your qualities. So those qualities, the teacher should encourage the students to acquire those qualities. They become the means of self-realization, jnanopayam. So the qualities are nityancha samachittatva mishtanishtopapattishu. So in life, as we live a life, so life is a flow. Life is not static. It is a dynamic equilibrium, even when it appears to be the same. Like yesterday you were in Hrishikesh in a camp, in a Vedanta camp, 10-day Vedanta camp. Today what are you? Today also you are in Hrishikesh. Again in the same Vedanta camp. Tomorrow also you will be in Hrishikesh. Again in the same Vedanta camp. This is what is called equilibrium. Same, equal. But is it a static equilibrium or dynamic equilibrium? It is dynamic equilibrium. Yesterday you were in Hrishikesh, today you are in Hrishikesh. But it is not the same Hrishikesh. And you are not the same person. It is not the same environs. Everything is changeful. Therefore, it's a dynamic equilibrium. Though it appears to be the same, still it is dynamic. So, that's a dynamic equilibrium. Life is a dynamic equilibrium. It appears the same. It is never the same. It is a dynamic equilibrium. And therefore, it is ever changeful. And as the life continues to flow and flow and flow, it brings all kinds of things before us, like the Ganga River. The river brings flowers sometimes. Sometimes you will be surprised, half-burnt body parts come in the flow, half-burnt. They don't have time to keep it, burn it all the way, because it requires more wood. Wood is very precious. Wood is like gold, you know that? Wood is like gold. And therefore, they use minimal wood. And if some small part of the body, some foot or some piece of hand, etc., is left out, nobody has time to burn it and all that. They push it into the river. And you will see it coming here. Sometimes you go into Ganga, it will touch. So life is like that. It brings the most abhorrent things in its wake. And it brings very pleasant things also, like flowers and some. Suddenly you find in a small thing, in a small leaf thing, a lamp is coming. Looks very beautiful. Immediately you want to take a photograph also. But you don't know all that oil will pollute the river. There will be oil and all of it will not be burnt completely, because one wave will upside down, turn it upside down, and all the oil will be poured into water. Oil is poison in water. The fish, they will die because they will not be able to breathe in and all that. People should not use that kind of things. They should think. Anyway, therefore the Ganga brings all kinds of things in its wake. Life is like Ganga. So it brings very pleasant things and it brings very ugly things also. But you have to maintain an equanimity. Always, nityancha samachittatvam ishtanishtopapattishu. You remain equanimous in the face of the opposites of life. You come across a very sensitive person, very sensible or sensitive, and then you come across a very rude person. In both cases, you should remain equanimous. Similarly, sometimes situations are very favorable, quite favorable. We feel very good. Sometimes situations are very distress, very painful. They cause a lot of distress. And so you should take that also in your stride. That kind of equanimity is a godly quality. People do not pay attention to these things. You see, in Gita, in the very first chapter, called Sankhya, first chapter I mean second chapter, don't worry about all that story and all that. That is all story. And don't try to do a lot of psychoanalysis about it. Even now people are doing. A Mahatma starts teaching Gita. He doesn't teach anything worthwhile. He teaches only Arjuna, Krishna, Krishna said this, Arjuna did this, he should not do that. Purvapaksha, Siddhanta, there only. Arjuna is right. What is wrong? He says, I will not kill people. He is right. No, he cannot be right. If he is right, then Krishna should become wrong. Therefore, Krishna must be right. Arjuna cannot be wrong. Right. And therefore, there must be a higher reason, different reason. Like that. Whole life is gone in this analysis. And nothing more than that. So, that guy, this way, you take a cue from Shankara. Shankara, he has put aside all of it quietly. He just did not even look at all that. Did not care to explain one verse there. In fact, there are some verses in the first chapter that require a commentary. Aparyaptam balam tvesham. Paryaptam balam. There, that wording, etc. It is so tricky. You have to be very cautious, otherwise you will make mistake. And Bhashyakara could help us there. He said, you fend for yourself. He did not look at all that. Okay, at least he should start from second chapter beginning. Klaibhyam asmagam of partha, etc. Some pep talk is there. He could comment on that. No, you take care of it. He started, Sri Bhagavan Vacha. That is where the Gita begins. Gita is a song, you know. That is so the concert, music concert begins when the vocalist begins the prayer. Vatapi Ganapatim Bhaja. Then the music concert begins. Not before that tabla adjustment or violin adjustment. All that is not music concert. So similarly, that is where Gita begins. 2:11, Gita is on. 2:12, Natva Vahan Jatunasam, etc. 2:13, 2:14. Suddenly you come across a verse, most stunning verse. He says, you become immortal, means you become liberated, now and here, if you fulfill just one condition. What is that condition? Sama Dukkha Sukham Dheeram. Dhera is viveki, discrimination. So you rise above the mind. Then you are ready. When you rise above the mind, when you don't identify with the mind, then you acquire an equanimity towards the pleasure and pain. Okay. It sounds like personality development. But he says, somrutatvaya kalpate. First line is Yamhinav Yathayantyete Purusham Purushar Shabha Samadukha Sukham Dhiram Somrutatvaya Kalpate. That means you remain equanimous, sober, in the face of the vicissitudes of life. You are now a divine person, a godly person. That is how he says, and he repeats it in the 13th chapter. So Nityancha Samachittatva Mishtanishtopapattishu. Then what? Mayi chananya yogena bhaktiravyabhicharani. There must be bhakti. See, generally, the devotion people have is a very convenient bhakti. It is. That is what it is. Convenient bhakti. So, it is you are relatively free now. You have finished all business activities and other samsara activities are all done. Now you have some free time, so let us do some bhakti. That kind of bhakti. And then, very popular bhakti you can see in India, the popular bhakti is, when you are in some trouble, immediately you remember all the gods and goddesses and offer vows. The vows are, if I get out of this trouble, I will this to you. Like, I will give this or that to you. That is the bhakti. You see, a person told, he did not have children. This is the, did not have children. Every story starts like that. Every story, he did not have children. Soma Sharma did not have children. Every story starts, that's why we are 1.25 billion. And yet counting. Still counting. So he did not have children. He wanted a son. Then he prayed to the goddess. Oh goddess, if I get a son, I will feed 1,000 people in your name. Or I will offer 1,000 kilo naivedyam to you. That is what it is. That is the ritual, you know. Giving food to others is not the ritual. This is the ritual. So I will give naivedyam, 1,000 kilo naivedyam to you. Then the wife became pregnant and she gave birth to a child. And then he has done jata karma and all that. Then the devata appeared in dream. These devatas appears in dream only. They don't come in waking state. So that has its own significance. Now the devata appeared in dream and said, where is the 1,000 kg naivedyam? Already you have the son and all that. Then he said, you see, I'm a simple guy. I'm not very rich. Simple business. My business is very simple business. I will not be able to give 1,000 kilo naivedyam. No, at that time you took a vow like that. No, that time my mind was like that, and therefore you cannot demand me that much. You have to understand my situation also. You should be ready to adjust for 100 kilo. Then the devata said, okay, agreed. So then do 100 kilo. Then the next day he woke up and he did not do. 1 month passed, he did not do. And then again devata came. Are, what happened to the 100 kilo? Then he says, you see, recently the economic downturn is there. Inflation is there and that is too much for me. I am getting some losses. I will do 10 kg. So this is the story. There is some ending. You imagine the ending to that. So this is called the bhakti, convenient bhakti. Very convenient bhakti. You see, that's why all our bhakti associated rituals are adjusted around breakfast and lunch. You got it? They are around breakfast and lunch. Finish before the breakfast time, or start after the breakfast and finish before the lunch time. Something like that. And also, the rituals have an important element in them, naivedyam. And through naivedyam, we can fulfill, satiate, or we can gratify our taste buds. That is how these naivedyams are visualized. Every naivedyam it has come from the gratification of taste buds. You want, in naivedyam, kaju must be there. Kaju, kismis must be there in naivedyam. Yalak, all these fragrant things must be there in naivedyam. Why? Because Bhagavan, you know. Where is the Bhagavan? Rasasya rasaha. That is the Bhagavan. So, this kind of bhakti, which is very commercial, very worldly, people have to think, I am saying it. You give credit to me that I am saying it, which you don't want to say or you are afraid to say, I am saying it. So, people have to think about it. This is not the bhakti. Some kind of bhakti, likely to take you to higher thing, probably. So, avyabhicharini, when you are in trouble, you are remain devoted. When you are happy, you remain devoted. At all times, you remain devoted. Your desire is fulfilled or not, you remain devoted. You remain devoted to Ishvara, because Ishvara happens to be your own true self. That way, you remain devoted. So, ananya yogena, that is the yoga. Yoga is the worship in which there is no anya. It means three things. I remember two of them. Anya, between me and my beloved God, there is no third thing. So I worship God because I love God. There is no third thing. Suppose I worship God for gaining heaven. Now, what is it that I love now? God or heaven? Heaven. That is called anya. Therefore, it is not yoga. Once anya, the third, between the devotee and God, if there is another element, another category, that becomes anya. Therefore, it is not a devotion anymore. I mean, it is not this kind of devotion. Ananya yogena bhakti hi avyabhicharini. And the bhakti, people become devotees only when they enter into temple. Inside the temple, they are devotees. Step out of the temple, he is not a devotee, he is a worldling. And then they become devotees at a specific times. In the morning hours, they are devotees. The appointment with God. There is an appointment with God. Between 7 and 7.30, that is the God time. During that time, he will not talk anything except doing puja. But up to 7 and after 7.30, he will be talking whole day. So this appointment with God. So you fix God in a place, and only inside that place God is there. This is the convenient bhakti. Even at home, the home need not be godly. Your heart need not be godly. In the home, you select a corner and make it God's place. Very narrow. Because you cannot afford to give away so much place, very, very precious it is. 1 square foot costs 10,000 rupees probably. You cannot lose so much for the sake of God. Why not allot 10 by 10 to God? No, that is too big. God doesn't need that much. Very clever, I tell you, very clever and cunning to the core. God means 4 by 3 in a corner. Again, vastu there. Very cunning. Vastu. It is this direction, this calculation, that calculation. Very worldly. And put an image there. And offer a flower. Do one namaskar. Close the door conveniently. Now God is done. Now we are free to do whatever we like in our world. This kind of bhakti is called vyabhicharini bhakti. Very unsure bhakti. It is there, it is not there. Vyabhichara means it is there, it is not there. In this place it is there. Step out of that place, gone. At this time it is there. Step out of that time, gone. In South India we have a fashion. Fashion means it's a religious thing. In India, religion is the mainstream. Therefore, on Saturday, they won't eat non-veg. On Saturday. Therefore, the non-veg people, they close their shops on Saturday. Nobody purchases non-veg that day. The sales are very low key. Sunday morning, you have to see. The animals are kept in line, cut one after the other, and sell the meat. Because they missed the meat Saturday, they compensate for it on Sunday. Why Saturday? Because Saturday is allotted to God. Which God? Venkateswara Swami. So we have a lot. People think that this is all devotion. Saturday for Venkateswara Swami, Tuesday for Hanuman, I don't know why. Thursday for Baba, other days our days only. All the 3 days, everybody will follow one day only. They are God days and the other days are our days. So people think this is all great. And they give wonderful names to it. It is a religion, it is a tradition. Shankaracharya, all the way to Shankara. So this is all very corrupted bhakti it is. Vyabhicharini. In space it changes, it alters, in place it alters, space-time. And you are devoted to one form and not caring for another form like that. It is not like that. And then devotion inspired by desires. That is not the real bhakti. Ananya yoga. There is no thing to be desired at all. Between me and my beloved, there is nothing else. There is nothing else. Between me and my beloved, there is nothing else. So then Ananya yoga is the God is not other than me, nor I am other than God. There is oneness. The God is the innermost self. That is the Ananya yoga. There is one more meaning for Ananya, I don't remember. So this way, this kind of devotion, at all times, in all places, you see the same God in all forms. And then there is no desire involved in your devotion to God. You see, God doesn't respond, therefore we are safe. God doesn't react, so we are safe. He has become a stone, therefore we are safe. So you try this with your spouse. I love you because your father is rich. You tell this to your wife and see what happens. I have so much love for you because you brought good dowry to me. You tell this to your wife and see what happens. She will throw you out. Poor God, he listens to all and keeps quiet. That's why he is God. Therefore, that is the bhakti. I have given you a glimpse of bhakti. There is a lot more to say about bhakti. So bhakti ravya vicharani. And then Ishwaraha and Bhashyakara. You see, there Bhashyakara says, Ishwaraha Mattaha Anyaha Na. Mattaha is from me. Panchami. Mat Tasil Mattaha. So, Ishwara is none other than my true self. That must be the Ananya Yoga. That is the bhakti. That's why when you go to the temple, you look at the form and then go beyond the form. You'll be looking at the form, that I need not tell. That cognition happens. But then go beyond the form. And visualize Om, the sound. Convert the shape. Some form you see, you know, some form or the other. It doesn't matter one way or the other. And you take this form and merge it in the sound. Rupa in Nama. The sound is Om. That is God now. And therefore, visualize every form, every image as Om, as the sound Om, not the letter Om written there. That is another form. That also you merge in the sound Om. And then while chanting Om, you visualize the God in your heart as the innermost self. That is the bhakti. And don't allow this desire, that desire to come into the mind. You can pray, O God, give me the strength of mind to face the opposites of life. That is not a desire. O God, give me the strength of mind to rise above these petty, mundane desires. That is not a desire. Don't be again technical about it. Take the spirit of what is being said. So a desire is a desire. Something which is not a desire is not a desire. So you have to cultivate that kind of bhakti, that is the real devotion. And then vivikta desha sevitvam. You have to repair to a lonely place. A lonely and a clean place. Vivikta also clean. But not only clean, a sacred place. Suppose a club is there. Very clean it will be, because they put people and they put Dettol and clean it all the time and then play cards. It's a clean place. No, that is not the kind of clean. Clean, relatively clean, but more important is it is sacred, not filled with undesirable people and all that. It is not about people. We are not against people. The things they do in a club, play cards and all that, not that kind of a place. That is the meaning of vivikta. That's why coming to Rishikesh and all that for that reason. And then repair into solitude. You have to cherish or relish solitude. That is amrutam. You stay in solitude. There cannot be anything more than that. And arrange for some food to be given to you. You can make such arrangement. You keep a small bag outside your door and arrange that the person will put the food in that bag and knock on the door at 12:30. And so you hear the knock, he will go away. He won't be standing there. You open the door, take the bag inside and close the door. Eat the food and wash the dishes and put them in the bag again and put to the hook outside and close the door. You need not even look at the person who has given you food. You make arrangement like that for 10 days and stay inside. And if you have to keep a phone so that some urgent work has to be attended to, go ahead, do it. And then keep books to read. And take a study, shravanam. And then keep a few gym things and do some exercise. Or you go for a walk if you have to go for a walk. And then come and lock yourself in. Do that sadhana for 10 days. It is worth doing. So you may try. You go to Uttarakashi and do it if you find Hrishikesh is not convenient. In Hrishikesh also you can do it for 10 days. Keep books and read. So you are with yourself. Occasionally, depending upon the urgency, you may give a phone call. But you don't receive any phone call. So like that you may try. Vivikta Desha Sevitvam. It helps you to discover the glory of solitude. When you live in solitude, you will know what is the beauty of solitude. When you live it. Suppose you read about it or you hear about it, that is not enough. Aratir Jana Samsadi. You see, this I told, you don't attend any parties. The only group of people into which you walk in is satsanga group. Like here, many people are sitting, you walk in and become part of the group because it is satsanga group. Any other group, you are not interested. You won't go in. Marriage, you won't go in. No, son's marriage, still you need not go. Son, you send the son. He gets married and comes back. And if the wife wants to go, let her go. Why should you go? You need not go. Son has got a son. You utterly you need not go. Absolutely you need not go for that. It is his, let him face the music himself. Why do you want to face the music along with him? So like that. Become free. And no parties, no marriage. Birthday party is the worst thing to attend. You don't do that. Why should you attend somebody else's birthday party? He wants to live in some delusion. And so you want to take part in the party of delusion. He is deluded that he was born. And you want to join the group. What for? No birthday. Then death day party, that is also unnecessary. There are death day parties also. Some in India, somebody dies and all the relatives go and sit there for 3 days. Why should they do it? He has to put a cook and make a food and serve all these people. Unnecessary, you know. So all these social customs, they are meaningless. You avoid them altogether. And then one more thing, Aratir Jana Samsadi. One more aspect of that. I feel like taking everything one notch higher. Or you want me to leave it where it is? Take it one notch higher. Suppose I am walking and somebody is coming. And I notice that he is coming and he goes without saying hello to me or without wishing me or without looking at me. There is freedom in it. Right? Suppose he says hello, then where is the freedom now? Now there is no freedom. Now you have to say hello again, and then he will ask, how are you doing? How do you do? Then you have to say, even if you are not doing well, you are supposed to say, okay, I'm doing all right. Then you have to ask him, how do you do? Howdy? You have to ask. So you have to ask. All of that is a pressure, you know, that inner pressure is operating. We are habituated to all of these things. That's why we don't find them for what they are. That is our problem. On the other hand, if somebody is coming and he doesn't even look at you, doesn't wish you, he sees you and ignores you and goes, oh my God, that is freedom. That is freedom. You should relish that kind of freedom. So aratir janasamsadi. Then adhyatma jnana nityatvam. You see, morning Vedanta, afternoon Vedanta, evening Vedanta. Vedanta, you have to understand what it is correctly. Vedanta is adhyatma jnana. Vedanta is not some ideational effort. So, all kind of transcendental speculation, that is not Vedanta. So, adhyatma it is. Brahma, you should visualize Brahma as part and parcel of adhyatma. Prachyakabhinna Brahma, not Brahma. Then Maya Shakti, adhyatma. Maya Shakti is operating here in the form of avidya. And also life force is Maya Shakti. Everything is adhyatma. And so not ideational Vedanta. So morning, afternoon and evening. You see, I suggest, if you don't mind, so I see things, that's why I suggest. I do not see from, I don't think I am justifying myself, just I am saying it to make things clear to you. I do not see from a judgmental point of view to punch holes in others. No, that is not the idea. Everybody is Atma. There is nothing to find fault with anybody. That is not the thing. But an observation without an observer, that kind of an observation is important, you know. So otherwise you become blind to what goes on around and you remain, you get deluded. It should not be. You see, there is a kind of a fad, I suppose, I can call it a fad, listen to Vedanta. Some kind of a fad. Now, you cannot, you may be willing to listen from morning to evening, but who can teach like that, you know? People have their own limitations. For example, I used to take 3 classes per day, year after year. For 30 years I have done. Never felt that it can be a burden. But now, for 2 classes, I have to plan lifestyle very carefully, very minutely I have to plan. And for example, if I drink a cup of tea, I cannot take class. Because the tea very badly affects the throat. I will not be able to take the class. Therefore, give up tea. Like that, you have to very minutely plan and for taking 2 classes. Of course, supported by 1 meditation and 1 satsanga. For that, you have to make a plan. And you have to readjust the entire lifestyle around that effort. Therefore, you can't expect to listen to Vedanta from morning to evening. That will not be possible. And then there are CDs. Earlier, we used to call it tapes. There are tapes, bundles and bundles of tapes, and a tape recorder. But now it has become CDs. Even that has gone now. CD is outdated now. CD is outdated. Once I thought this 3 1/4 inch floppy disk is that is enough for me, I will end my life with that. That is what I thought. Then I used to use floppy disks only. Then a stage comes when there is no place to put the floppy disk anymore. The computer doesn't accept floppy disks at all. And when I go to the office and want some floppy disks, they say, Swamiji, we don't have them, we will get them for you. And then they tell me they are not available in Pennsylvania market, they are not available. Then I have shifted from floppy disk to CD. Then I decided, I took a vow, I will end my life with the CDs. But even that is not going to work, I tell you. Now pen drives, small buttons, and now put everything in it and listen. From morning, afternoon, evening, you will be listening. Laid back. That is not that way. It should not be like that. This laid back Vedanta. Once I came across a young man. Young man must be, how he must be, how energetic he must be, how well geared towards knowledge. That must be a young man. A young man, dull, as if an old guy, and not very active, lazy, it is a very bad sight. I came across a young man. What are you doing nowadays? Just I casually asked. Not that I wanted to know or anything, as part of the conversation. So he comes and touches the feet. So then you have to say, hello, how are you? What are you doing? Like that I asked. He said, I am doing a course. Course was over, you know. It was over. It was finished. How come you are doing a course? No, I am listening to the tapes. So you call it doing a course? So how do you listen? Morning I listen, afternoon I listen, evening I listen. And then have some nice breakfast in the morning, 6 idli. And a good lunch and followed it up with a dinner. By the time he finishes his course, he will become in all probability a diabetic. A pre-diabetic certainly, if not a diabetic. So not like that. You have to bring quality into all that. Shravanam is go to a class. Wherever the class is there, go to it and sit there. If the class is 1,000 miles, now 1,000 miles is nothing. 1,000 miles, if you take a flight, in 2 hours you cover. In 2 hours you will land there. What is 1,000 miles? Nothing. So, therefore, you go wherever the class is there. A quality equal a class, not some class. So I am going to listen Vedanta. Oh, who is teaching? I don't know, somebody is teaching, doesn't matter. I will go and listen. Now, you call that Shravanam? So that means what? Whatever is being said, you will listen. This is called professional shrotas. No use. It should not be like that. What you listen must be quality. It must be quality Vedanta. Not some elementary thing. Elementary thing mane kya hota hai? Look, this universe has come from God, from Brahma. You don't say God. God is bhakti. Brahma is jnana. Now it is all jnanam. Because instead of saying God, Rama or Krishna, you say Brahma. Therefore you are a Vedantin. So universe has come from Brahma. And then the universe is sustained by Brahma. What universe? Who is sustaining? When did you see Brahma? Some ideational Vedanta. So, you got it all wrong, I tell you. I mean, what is said is correct. But the way it is said, the spirit in which it is said, the way you listen to it, and the kind of notions that you acquire, all of them, they are technically correct, but in reality, they don't mean much. That's why people remain a bag of bones. Even after listening to Vedanta for 10 years or 20 years. Sometimes the Zika virus comes and you get a weird Vedantin. So these are all some of the pitfalls associated with Vedanta Shravanam. I said all these things because I love all of you. And I want you to know what is Adhyatma Jnana Nityatvam. That is a very powerful expression. So you see, you cannot complain. Swamiji, we are listening to Vedanta for 10 days, but then when we go back again, we go back to the normal ways of the world. Means what? Who asked you to go back to the normal ways of the world? Who asked you? No, we go back. Why should you go back? Why should you? You see, you have come from the mud. The leg, the feet, etc., everything is muddy, and then go to the shower and take bath and become clean. Why should you go back to the mud? Why? Because you want to take shower one more time. That's why you want to go back to the mud. Now, that is not a sensible thing to do. You don't do that. So, you see, light and life, they should not be at two different levels. They should be at the same level. Light, life. So there is, light is here and you live here. Should not be like that. When the light is there, you should live in the light only. I mean, I am putting in metaphorically. Therefore, you have to allow the life to be guided by the truth, which only means by the common sense. That is Vedanta. the basic tenets by which you live a life, a day-to-day life, that is Vedanta. Like somebody insults you. Insult is what? The ego clashes could be very dangerous. The other person frowns on your heart. That could be the level of ego. He may not be frowning at you. He may be frowning at somebody else or at himself. But still your heart. Oh, he put it. You see his face, how he put it. And after seeing me, he doesn't even smile at me. So you are already hurt. So that is the level of ego that drives the people's lives. Do you know this? In India, yesterday we were talking of pithadhipatis and all that. Some of the pithadhipatis, they don't meet each other, because if they meet each other, they don't know who has to do namaskar first. Now we are talking of the liberated souls. Sometimes they practice untouchability. What is the liberation there? Suppose somebody is practicing untouchability. Now you mean to say he is a brahmajnani, therefore he can do anything, therefore he is practicing untouchability. Can you justify it like that? Therefore, you have to get the spirit of Vedanta into your life, the basic tenets by which you live a life. You see, life is lived, and there is always a guiding light behind the life that you live, a guiding light. And that guiding light, you have to reorganize, readjust. The tenets by which you lead a life have to be rehashed or restructured. You have to do that. And people do that. Good-meaning people do that. Therefore, not difficult at all. Suppose, you see, you don't laugh at me. One day I was alone in the room. There are three chairs like this. So these chairs, these plastic chairs, you know, very light. You can easily lift. So I put one more chair in that, and they can all be put like that. One into it and one into it. Now it has got some weight. Now I lifted it and doing like this. And somebody saw from the window in Salersburg. He told in the office, "Hey, the Swami lifts the chairs like that." Then the general manager came and asked me, "Swamiji, what are you doing?" I said, "I am keeping diabetes away." "Oh, is it like that?" "Yeah. I need to keep the muscle mass intact. I cannot allow the muscle to be totally lost. I am not going to any boxing ring or any such thing, but the muscle mass I have to keep. And the doctor told me to do that exercise because I have got some cuff tendonitis." "Oh, is it like that?" "Yeah." Then he went and asked the doctor and brought some weights, 5 pounds, 7 pounds, 3 pounds, like that, each two weights, some 4 or 5 pairs he got and put in my room. Now I am using those weights. You have to live the life based on certain tenets of understanding. So you have to keep diabetes away. And so whatever needs to be done to keep diabetes away, you have to do it. No, we do it in the yoga studio, but when we come out of it, we don't do it. What kind of argument it is? That only proves the point. That only shows that you don't have earnestness. That is all. That is the description. That only shows that you don't have earnestness. You just pay lip sympathy and leave it at that. If diabetes keeps away by itself, you are happy. But if it comes near, you are not willing to do what all needed to keep it away. And sometimes people are willing to do a ritual to keep diabetes away. Now, you do it by all means. Do a ritual to keep diabetes away. The ritual is walk 2 miles and come back. That is the ritual. Is that not a ritual? Take to the name of the Lord, say Hare Rama, Hare Rama, and walk 2 miles and come back. So that is the ritual. Therefore, you have to live the life based by the principles of truth. సో దట్ ఈస్ కాల్డ్ అధ్యాత్మ జ్ఞాన నిత్యత్వం, నాట్ సమ్ లేడ్ బ్యాక్ వేదాంత. సో దెర్ మస్ట్ బి అండర్స్టాండింగ్ ఆఫ్ లైఫ్ ఇన్ ది మార్నింగ్, ఇన్ ది ఆఫ్టర్నూన్, ఇన్ ది నైట్ అండ్ హోల్ డే, డే ఆఫ్టర్ డే. అండ్ యూ హ్యావ్ టు లివ్ ఎ లైఫ్ గైడెడ్ బై ది లైట్ ఆఫ్ ది ట్రూత్. దట్ ఈస్ కాల్డ్ అధ్యాత్మ జ్ఞాన నిత్యత్వం. అండ్ దెన్ సర్వ తత్వజ్ఞానార్థ దర్శనం, దట్ ఈస్ ది లాస్ట్ వన్. దీస్ ఆర్ వెరీ డిఫికల్ట్ ఎక్స్ప్రెషన్స్. డిఫికల్ట్ మీన్స్ యూ హెవ్ టు కాన్షియస్లీ ఫాలో ఇట్ అండ్ లుక్ ఎట్ శంకర. యూ షుడ్ హ్యావ్ దర్శనం, విషన్, ద విషన్ ఆఫ్ ద మోక్ష. దట్ విషన్ యూ షుడ్ హ్యావ్. మోక్ష ఈజ్ ది అవుట్కమ్ ఆఫ్ ది నాలెడ్జ్, నాలెడ్జ్ ఆఫ్ నాట్ సమ్ స్క్రిప్చర్స్. ఇట్ ఈజ్ నాట్ స్క్రిప్చరల్ నాలెడ్జ్ పెర్సే, సంథింగ్ మోర్ దెన్ స్క్రిప్చరల్ నాలెడ్జ్. సో తత్వస్య జ్ఞానం, తస్య అర్థః ప్రయోజనం మోక్ష, తస్య దర్శనం, దట్ ఈస్ ది ఎక్స్ప్రెషన్. సో యూ షుడ్ హ్యావ్ ది విషన్ ఆఫ్ ఫ్రీడమ్. యు సీ పీపుల్, దే ఆర్ గుడ్ మీనింగ్ పీపుల్, బట్ దే డోంట్ హ్యావ్ ది విషన్ ఆఫ్ ఫ్రీడమ్. దట్ ఈస్ ది ప్రాబ్లమ్. యు సీ, సపోజ్ ఐ ఆమ్ ది హెడ్ ఆఫ్ ఎన్ ఆశ్రమ్, సపోజ్. దెన్ ఐ హ్యావ్ ఎ విషన్. వాట్ ఈస్ ది విషన్? సో ఎక్స్పాండ్ ది ఆశ్రమ్. సమ్ ల్యాండ్ ఈజ్ అవైలబుల్ బై ది సైడ్, గ్రాబ్ ఇట్. గ్రాబ్ ఇట్ మీన్స్ పర్చేజ్ ఇట్ బిఫోర్ సంబడి ఎల్స్ పర్చేజెస్. దట్ ఈస్ ది విషన్. అండ్ దెన్ పుట్ ఏ బిల్డింగ్ దేర్, అండ్ దెన్ పుట్ ఏ టాప్ ఫ్లోర్, అండ్ దెన్ డూ దిస్, డూ దాట్. దట్ ఈస్ ది విషన్. నౌ ఈజ్ దట్ ది విషన్? Suppose as the head of the place, if that is my vision, what kind of vision? I am not the head of the place, just I am saying if, with an if. So don't get me wrong. So that is not the vision. That is the worldly thing it is. So, and then the head of the place, therefore the place has certain clout. Like in economics, or in commerce, not economics, in commerce, the business house has got something called goodwill. Goodwill is a technical term. And when the business is purchased by another person, this man sells and somebody else purchases it, they don't change the name because the name has a goodwill. And the people relate to it readily. If you change the name, now you have to struggle to put the new name into the minds of the people. That requires a lot of effort and money. Whereas the name is already made, therefore keep it. Colgate. It is a made name, a name which is already made. The owners may change, you don't even know that. Like Tim Hortons coffee is there in Canada. Now Tim Hortons has died in a car accident. He is not anymore. And then his wife inherited the coffee empire, Tim Hortons. And she is a lady, how she can run this empire? She told it to, she sold it. Some Burger King or somebody purchased it. Nobody knows it. Nobody knows it. Because Tim Hortons, that remains. They won't change it to Burger King or some other name. Because it has a goodwill associated with it. Therefore, the ashram chiefs are no better than this. They want to keep the clout of the ashram going. The ashram has certain clout in the society. The petha or the matha has certain clout, and they have to keep it and increase it. That is the vision. Now, do you like this vision? Do you want to subscribe to that kind of a vision? At least be selfish the right way. Be selfish, at least be selfish the right way. So that is not the vision. The vision is moksha, freedom. Freedom. Atmarthe prithivin tyajet. For the sake of self-knowledge, you are willing to give up the kingdom, the entire kingdom. Bhartruhari did that. Bhartruhari was a wonderful monarch, great king. Those days all kings were monarchs. So Bhartruhari, He was a great monarch, and then one day he decided to give it up, to gain self-knowledge. He called his brother, his name is Vikrama, Vikramaditya, called him, "Dear brother, this kingdom is yours from tomorrow morning." And he walked away. He told his wife, "Take as much gold and money you want and go to your parents' place." She was happy to go there and put her in a chariot and send her to parents' home. No children. He gave the kingdom to her brother and walked away and became a student of Vedanta. It is not about sannyasa. Sannyasa is just a commitment, a ritual that establishes a commitment in your heart that you will devote the rest of the life for the self-knowledge. That is the sannyasa. Then why the robes to get bhiksha? That is the purpose. In Hyderabad, if I wear, I don't mind wearing dhoti and shirt white. I don't mind. Sometimes I do it also. But if I do that in Hyderabad, I won't get bhiksha. So very practical thing it is. I am telling you based on a long experience. And then in Hrishikesh also, sadhu is different, kashayambaradhari is different from white. In the Bhandara, some white people also strain and we oblige them. But our focus is on the kashaya people. So that gets you bhiksha. That's why. Otherwise, sannyasa is what? It is not a ritual or any such thing. Sannyasa is you own up that vision. And what is the vision? Vision of moksha, freedom. Freedom is the vision, liberation. That is the vision. What you need is liberation, not some more money. That is not what you need. People got it all wrong. In fact, they have more than enough money already. Already they have more than what they require. They are not going to enjoy all that money which they have accumulated. They don't need more money. They need some common sense, which is such a rare thing. And they don't need more pleasures because they will become sick. Bhoge roga bhayam. You see, everywhere very good hotels and very good hospitals, side by side. That is how the bastis are. There was a lot of development in this area. What is the development? So many hotels. And then, so many hospitals, all side by side. This is one mafia and that is like that. So, it is a no-win game. Therefore, you don't need all of that. You are pursuing the wrong goals in life. You don't need all of that. Then religious rituals. For what? Religious rituals for what? What is the ritual? How is the ritual? Why is the ritual? You have to ask this question. Heaven. You should say, "I don't want heaven." Then what do you want? "I want freedom." Freedom comes from knowledge, doesn't come from karma. Nastya kratah kritena. It comes from knowledge. Oh, it comes from knowledge? Then I will acquire knowledge. Knowledge of what? Agama Shastra. No. No Agama Shastra. Otherwise, Jyotisha Shastra. No. Vastu Shastra. No. Shukuna Shastra. No. Prashna Shastra. What are all these shastras? Shastrapasadaha, not shastrani. Pseudo-shastras. There is only one shastra. Shankara said or Madhusudana Saraswati said, Vedanta darshanam, darshaniyatamam darshanam, darshananam darshanam. It is a vision, the vision of visions, the most beautiful vision. The vision of Adhyatma Vidya, the knowledge of the tattva, the reality. You discover the truth, discover the reality. Discover. Like a desire. What is it? And why should I pursue it? Explore and discover. And if it has to be pursued, pursue it. So discover the truth. of the world. What is the world? And discover the truth of yourself. What am I? Who am I? They discover the truth of yourself. Be humble and admit, I don't know who am I. I don't know. It is such an amazing thing that I don't know who am I. A tremendously amazing thing. And so be humble, acknowledge that I don't know, and then try to discover the truth. In discovering the truth, there is freedom, there is liberation. In fact, the moment you feel like discovering the truth, already you feel, you taste the glory of liberation. Tatva jnana artha darshanam. So the acharya should impart all these instructions to the student. Grahayet, samyag grahayet. We'll come back to the next sentence. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam.